This program is brought to you by Hungry Jack's and Bunnings Trade.
Well, g'day punters. Now, we all know it by now, Bet With Mates, one of the best betting features you can find. It just makes betting together so, so much easier. And the best part of it, you don't just have to do it for your singles, your race singles, your NBL single games, overs, unders. You can put your mates multi in there together. I'll tell you what, there's plenty of sport on the menu coming up. We've got the footy going. The Perth Wildcats are about to win the minor premiership, I reckon. That's your free tip for this one, to chuck into your mates multi. But of course, maybe my Swans to win in there as well. Plenty of different options, as I said before. Betting together has never been so easy than it has with Bet With Mates. And the best part, you can even rate your mates' tips with emojis out there. I know which ones I'd be using. Enjoy and gamble responsibly. I'm never off my grind. I'm always on time. I'm ahead of the game. I'm first place. I'm in my prime. Hard work that pays off. I pay dues. I'm paid off. Cross me, get crossed off. I'm so fresh. I'm so raw. Go hard like A-Day.
Two seasons on the road has taken its toll on the New Zealand Breakers, and today they are desperate to snap a three-game losing streak and begin their climb off the bottom of the NBL ladder. But their opponents, the Cairns Taipans, are eyeing a rare win of their own. And given that just 1 point separated these teams when they last met, another fierce contest seems inevitable as we welcome you to the Cairns Convention Centre as round 17 of the Hungry Jacks NBL continues. Hi everyone, I'm John Casey alongside Liam Santamaria and Andrew Gaze. Home game for New Zealand in Cairns. Taipans will like that. They'll be familiar with the surroundings, but they're due a win, New Zealand. Desperately unlucky. Overtime loss to Brisbane. Let's hope they can get one here.
Yeah, absolutely. They've had a tough run of it, but having said that, been highly competitive, and somehow or other they find ways to lose games in some of the most remarkable set of circumstances, which we saw earlier on in the week against the Brisbane Bullets. But they've got a very talented lineup, and if you look at their recent form, they're putting points on the board against a team in the Cairns Taipans that struggled to score. This is a very nice looking starting lineup with Suva, Hugo Bosson, and Tom Abercrombie. Wetzel and Lowe gets the start. So it's interesting times for both these teams, and I guess they would be using the remaining game of the season to think about the future.
You mentioned Tom Abercrombie on the DoorDash starting five there. Coming off a 21-point game, season high, hit six triples. Nice to see him back in form. And Peyton Seaver's playing well also, putting some numbers up. And, of course, this is the heartbreak you spoke about, Drewy, the way things ended up on Thursday night against the Bullets. The pick-off from Deng Deng after the ill-advised pass from Will McDowell-White, and then Drimmy goes bang!
He's 7 points up with 20 seconds to go.
Nah, can't lose that.
It's impossible to lose. Well, we thought it was, but the New Zealand Breakers, it sort of epitomises what they've had to deal with this season. The heartbreak, the agony, they just can't seem to get a reward losing 9 out of their last 10.
Well, and not only that, Andrew, but it becomes a habit. They've lost their last 3 overtime games this season, and if you dig a little deeper, 9 of the last 10 overtime games New Zealand have played, they'd lost.
Yeah, that's heartbreak. That man right there, Yanni Wetzel, has to be a focus. Mm-hmm. Big first half on Thursday, 15 points at halftime. Didn't see enough of it in the second half. And, of course, he torched the Taipans when they met earlier in the season.
Yeah, 23 and 12 rebounds and 6 steals. He took them apart, and he's done this to other teams as well.
Yeah, and you see the numbers there, 23 points, 12 rebounds. Let's not forget about the 4 helpers. And what about the assists? He steals as well. But he's so strong at the rim, is Yanni Wetzel. And the way in which he can work that pick and roll. But down this end of the floor, this has been the big concern for the New Zealand Breakers. They've shown over the last 5 games they can put points on the board. But defence is not something that goes around the house. The Nile's not a river in Egypt. They've got to make sure that they get their act together in order to play a little something down the other end.
Well, let's hope the commentary's going to improve, Andrew Gaze, as this unfolds. The DoorDash starting five for the Cairns Taipans. So they've made a change as well, Liam.
Yeah, well, to Jim McCall there, right of your screen, he's suited up. Not expected to play is the word we're getting out of Cairns. He's got a bit of a hip issue coming out of their last game. So that's a big change. So Kawotnoi comes into the starting line. They're really going to miss to Jim McCall, brings so much to their squad in a variety of ways.
Well, he's their leading scorer, 15 a game, and is top five in the league in assists and steals. Mm. It's a massive hole for them and an opportunity for the New Zealand Breakers, who are due a win, 5-16 on the season. They are out of contention for the playoffs, even mathematically, where they can't make it.
Well, they've got to find a way, the Cairns Taipans, to get Scott Machado going. He's been good at times, but 27% on the season from the field. They got to find a way. When you're only putting up a little over 70 points a game, you've got to find a way to get that man some opportunities to put the ball in the hole, and he needs to be able to deliver.
Work the ball down low. Pender, extra pass for Deng, bounced off him, and a chance now for the Breakers to rush back the other way. Abercrombie, nice suggestion of a travel there. Short arm the shot nonetheless, and Machado the rebound. Picks up the dribble. Chuk Deng shares it. Now Portnoy reaching in foul is going to be called on Hugo Besson.
Well, Portnoy, first game in double digits on Thursday night since round two. Put 12 on the board. He's had a bit of a rough season. Injury has kept him out of most of the year. He's not in peak condition, unfortunately, but still looking to be aggressive and trying to give him something.
And last season as well, he's had a lot of problems keeping his body right, and hopefully he can get a good run at it because he's got all the tools. He's got good size, good bounce. He can shoot it as well. Just needs a good run of keeping his body in shape.
Fourth member of our commentary team, Alex Loughton, is courtside in Cairns to see Keanu Pinder open scoring.
Well, it's tropical far north Queensland, but for tonight's purposes, it's tropical far north New Zealand as they host the Cairns Taipans. The first time Taipans have been on the away end of the side of the court there. But for last game, the Taipans struggled to establish early inside and then build on the outside. They were shooting too many threes and coach didn't like the shot selection. So already in this game, the Taipans are establishing early in the paint and then they can build out from there.
Yeah, it's a good call, Lousy, and a couple of early buckets for Pinder close to the rim. Certainly, it's been an issue for him all season. Last in the league in three-point percentage is Abercrombie. That's vintage stuff from the Breakers franchise all-time leading scorer.
Well, he needs to have a big one, and you just... It's also about the psyche of the New Zealand Breakers. When you're losing so often and heartbreak ones where you've got good chances, been a real good chance to beat the Perth Wildcats, really had the game won against Brisbane, find ways to lose, that can play on your mind and you just feel like that the hoop gods are against you. Somehow or other, they've got to be able to maintain that positive attitude.
Rob Lowe from deep off the mark. Noy with the rebound and running. Good feed. Dang for the flush. So two dunks in their first 6 points for the Taipans.
Nice start. Good run out in transition there from Majuk Deng. That's one guy that they would love to get going. He's had a bit of a rough time over the past month or so. Trying to find his groove again.
Abercrombie fouled. Gets it done. Chance at a three-point play here.
Well, whether it's by design or just the circumstances of the game, we see the breakout two-hand dunk by Deng. But I don't know if the New Zealand Breakers have had an offensive set that's lasted more than 8 seconds, 9 seconds. They're coming down and really trying to push the tempo. What, early, quick action, a little pin down. They've had run the last couple of times for this man and he's been able to knock it down. And with a team that you look down the other bench and you see so many outs that maybe they just figure that they can go to their depth and run them off their legs because they have been very aggressive on the offensive end with early quick shots.
Tom Abercrombie playing just his seventh game of the season. Pender looking like an offensive foul there. Just went a little too aggressively.
This is what they've missed. The Breakers from Abercrombie is his versatility defensively. I mean, he's matched up on Scott Machado right now. He's guarding the point guard, but he gets switched on to Pender and he bodies up in the block, keeps position and takes the offensive foul.
Well, you see that the good in Pender and that time there, just in a bit of a hurry and just barrels into Abercrombie. He's made a couple of good plays around the rim. Just needs to assess it, not predetermine what he wants to do. And I believe there's, well, he actually might, I think they're appealing this coach's challenge, early coach's challenge, and 40 is arguing that Abercrombie hooked, pinned it down low. Look at the right arm.
Yeah, he's not going to win that.
I doubt very much he'll win.
First contact was the shoulder into the chest.
Correct. I think it's a very ambitious early call.
Yeah. The coach's challenge is unsuccessful. Mm-hmm. The call remains white 25, offensive foul.
Well, he's just lost his groove a little, Adam Ford.
Yep.
He's lost his flow with the coach's challenge.
And 8 out of 9.
He had 8
there's
in a row.
There's the charge and there's the hold. So the hold was, he definitely hooked him.
Yes.
But it was well after.
Chicken was before the egg on this occasion.
I'm loving what I'm hearing because of the wing action reference that you're referring to as well.
Yes, there you go.
And you've just put that together nicely, packaged it up in some really A-grade finals type commentary.
Just getting ready. They're only just around the corner, Case.
4 minor rounds to go. Late April playoffs underway. A lot to look forward to in the Hungry Jacks NBL. New Zealand come forward here. Down a point. First 3 minutes of the opening quarter. The third of our triple header in the Hungry Jacks NBL today.
Looked like they were going for a, might have been a little hammer action on the weak side. And Siva tries to get to the basket. Not necessarily to score, but looking for the weak side action, but he gets forced out of bounds. And another very quick action and turnover to the Breakers.
Into this time, not as aggressive against Abercrombie.
It's much better.
And nice finish as well.
That's what he needed to do the first time. Square up. Check out what he's got going for it. He's got a size advantage on Abercrombie. I don't mind you switching with Abercrombie because he can guard 1 through 4 at the very least, and sometimes 1 through 5.
I'll tell you, they're getting plenty of success out of this action. The Breakers, the down screen on the weak side, Wetzel, and they bring Abercrombie to curl up out of those actions. And this is something he's very comfortable with. Been doing it his entire career for the Breakers, catch and shoot on the elbow, and now he's ripping it. He's ripping it through and on the attack. Of course, well, as soon as they start to overreact to that, you got Yanni Wetzel down low. So the Breakers trying to milk that cow right now.
Well, they certainly are, and it's just Abercrombie.
Just staying with the farm sort of stuff. Drew it.
Oh, again, it's really impressive.
73% free throw shooter in his career, Tom Abercrombie. 365th game tonight.
And he's got plenty left in him.
Yeah.
Provided his body holds up, you can see even in this one, the way he's moving when he's in, he does not carrying those injuries, he's still got some bounce and basketball IQ.
So 39% three-point shooter on his career as well. More than 500 makes. And they're good numbers.
Speaking of makes, this man right here, Bull Qual, on the attack here. Draws the foul. He's going to the stripe.
Well, he's 1 of 11 from the three-point line.
Not a lot of makes.
That's not enough.
On Thursday.
That's definitely not enough.
But he is one make away from quite an historic achievement, Case.
It is.
It'll be his 50th made three-pointer in his rookie campaign if he can get it done. And what is even more remarkable about that, he'll be the first Aussie rookie since Brad Newley in 2005 to make 50 threes in a regular season.
Although there is a small asterisk next to that, given Dejan Vasiljevic last year made 49 threes before he was injured and was well on his way to getting to the 50 mark. But it still, that takes nothing away from what Bull Qual has done. He's been one of the surprise packets of the season, averaging 11 points and, as you say, those threes have come at 39%.
Is he the rookie of the year?
Pretty close.
Luke Travers, Isaiah Liafa.
Luke Travers, he started in an NBL Grand Final series. I find it hard to
box. Well, as per the technicalities and the eligibility.
True, but there is also
man's in the race.
Well, do you think he should be in the race?
Well, I think that needs a little tinkering. Because he had a big impact last year.
That's what I'm saying.
And it feels strange to call him, quote-unquote, a rookie.
Politics beckons for Liam Santa Maria. He gets asked a host of questions during a basketball game and fails to answer any of them.
Please.
He doesn't want to.
What about the triple team? Pinder down low. Pinder's got off to a good start. They don't send two, they send three. and they forced the turnover. Pinned a perfect 3 of 3 from the field. There's the two. And Lowe says, I want to join in the action. Might have been a little push.
Cairns by a point. Middle stages of the opening quarter. Home game for New Zealand in Cairns, as they have done in Adelaide, Tasmania, other areas while they're on the road. And a fall away all the bottom of the net for Besson puts the New Zealand Breakers on top for the first time.
Well, your man, Drew, is coming off a couple of rough ones. Single-digit games. Besson, last two, 0 of 11 combined from three. He's hoping he can get going today.
We'll leave Majuk Deng of the ball after he just lost control. Seaver, Wetzel. Works into the paint. The hook shot. Won't count.
Offensive.
Offensive foul.
Yeah, just reached out with the left arm to get called for the offensive hook foul. And didn't really need to do it. Comes in here. The hook at the end, just not a lot in it.
No. Let's get courtside to Alex Loudon again.
Hugo Besson's maturity has really come into a really good moment in this year. He's speaking with Dan Shamir just before, and he was saying that he was trying to show Hugo some EuroLeague clips, and Hugo's like, nah, you know what, I don't really watch those kind of clips. And Coach Shamir, he loves it. He loves the confidence of this young man, but he's really grown in maturity as a player, but as a man as well. That's why he's in the Australian League, to do his thing.
Here he is on cue, coming up with the finish as well. That's nice. And while we've got you there, Alex, did I hear you right earlier? You said that the Cairns Taipans, did they move out of the home rooms for this game? I can see they're at the other end, but...
Yeah, they're at the away bench this time. They get the away team treatment. There's just a few little graphics on the big screen for the couple of families that's in town. But they're trying to make it as comfortable as possible for the home side. It's nice, some nice little touches. The GM of New Zealand giving them a warm welcome at the start of the game. And they've a lot of energy in their huddles pre-game. So they're really trying to just get the juices flowing on that home court as best they can in a really tough situation.
Well, I know the Adelaide 36ers didn't give up their home change rooms when they hosted, or New Zealand hosted them at Titanium or at Adelaide 36ers Arena. And I can guarantee, though I wasn't there, that the Tasmania Jack Jumpers would not have given up their home change rooms because when New Zealand hosted them, because they are adorned with magnificent Tasmanian Jack Jumpers logos. They wouldn't want to be in there anyway. But good on the Cairns Taipans, because this has been an enormously tough road for the New Zealand Breakers for the past two seasons. And full credit to them for sticking at it. They are, in fact, they don't have a player this year, this season, that's played every game. They are the only team in the competition. Not one player has played every game. And you look at someone like Tasmania, who have 8 players who have played every game, and that gives you an idea of what they're up against. And difficult for everyone, but on New Zealand, you really do feel for them.
You know what? They've got to think of some way to
compensate them.
And
without a doubt.
A lot of ideas. And one of the ones I like the most, which I doubt very much will get up, but if next season when it returns to normal, that they only have to play everyone else once away and they play everyone else twice at home.
Yep.
Just as a little kicker to say thank you for the last 2 years that you've gone through, because it's horrific what they've had to deal with.
Yeah, it really is.
It is, and it's affecting the entire franchise. You know, their overall record, of course. They're 5-16 this season. Last season, they were 12-24 in that expanded season with the NBL Cup, but they're heading for their worst ever result in terms of wins in a season, which at the moment stands at 9-23 back in 2005 when they finished last, bottom of the ladder of the 11th. It's just not fair, and certainly I would like to see something like that, Andrew. I know it's going to be tough to orchestrate that, but they deserve something. No one's going to begrudge them a win if they can prevail here.
And we talk about the players and how difficult it is for them to be away from their families and friends and loved ones for all that stretch of time, play the entire season on the road. As the Taipans roll it in down low to Nate Jawai. Sam Timmons picks up the personal. But you also got to think about the fans. You know, the passionate Breaker home fans that don't get to the games and cheer on their squad for basically two years in a row. I mean, in Auckland, they didn't really even get that chance last season when they played a couple of those games late in the year. And then I also think about ownership. I mean, the ownership group, Matt Walsh and co, really tough situation when you're not getting any of those gate receipts and the money that comes in from a hosting game. So really tough couple of years. Here's hoping they can finish the season strong. Hugo Besson, Usman Dieng can get drafted in the first round and they can get a little kickback as a result of that process and look forward to bigger and brighter things next season.
And I think that that's going to be the priority. You see Usman Dieng on the court right now, but just give him and Hugo Besson as much time as you possibly can to give him that chance. And there's a little shuffling of the feet.
Thank you.
And he's one that's also grown. When he came out here, he had a rough start shooting the ball. In the last 5 to 10 games, thereabouts, there has been some good growth in him. And I know from the few NBA scouts that have called me up about various players in this competition, they still are very high on Usman Dieng.
They certainly are. Right now, ranked number 19 in ESPN's top 100. Besson 32, Dieng 19. Of course, Dyson Daniels in at number 10, playing NBA Ignite program.
I like this from the Taipans. Nature-wise, not going to play a big load of minutes. So when he is out there, feed the big fella.
Yeah.
Put him in the block, give him some touches, make the defense have to react, and see if he can make a problem out of him during his minutes on the floor.
Well, this is his 10th game of the season. He's played half the season. He's averaging only 9 minutes. And to really get the best off him, obviously making the focus, but if we could get him more minutes, then I think everyone would enjoy that, because when he's out on the floor, things happen.
Well, you know what? No matter who's guarding him, even in those 9 minutes, if you don't send double teams, I don't know anyone in this competition that can cover him single coverage. Just too big. And that time's Tim. We saw Timmons. He didn't do a whole lot wrong and still gets called for a foul, such as the big fella and the way he can just move people around down low.
Well, Sam Timmons has had some good games. I think there's a lot of upside for him. Connects there. Now a chance for Taipans and Paul Kual up the floor. Aiden Inga presenting down low with a mismatch, but they elect to go around the perimeter. Joe White against Timmons, muscling his way in once more and going back to the free throw line.
There we go. Right back at the well for the Taipans. And Jawai, I like his assertiveness, calling for it down there. Machado sends it back to Bull Kual. Say, feed the big fella. And a quick, strong move to the middle. And another trip to the foul line.
Game number 204 for Nate Jawai.
And this Cairns team, it's going to be interesting to see what happens to them in the off-season and how they rebuild. Is it just a matter, Liam, of maybe looking into your import spots and trying to find a combination there? Or because it's commonly referred to that they don't have the same resources as a lot of the other teams.
No, they don't.
And going after big-time Australian recruits is difficult for them. So it's not... It's not an easy set of circumstances.
Well, some munchies.
Well, Nate Jawai just looking after the home faithful. Oh, here on. Is the away team, was it?
Hold on.
Although,
hold on.
Stand by.
We're shooting that second one again.
Makes the adjustment.
So no burgers on offer. Adam Ford wasn't happy with some yelling from the breakers end of the floor during that first free throw attempt from Jawai.
Why?
Just didn't feel like it was all that appropriate.
And the Taipans on top by 5 here. It's a game-high lead. They scored the first 4. Onside, Jawai gets the dunk and expands the margin even further out to 7.
What a pass from Machado.
Yanni Wetzel upset, because if he's going to help on those on-ball screens, someone's got to cover him, and he was left to get back to help and then recover, and no one there, and you could see him a little upset with his teammates for not getting that rotation. And if they come off those on balls and there's no ball pressure and you leave the guy with the ball and there's no help on the roller, it's almost impossible to get back in time, particularly when you've got a big target like Jawai down low.
Let's go fist side, but via up. Start with thumb up, okay?
You go this way, Jawai's in this corner.
Okay. So start from here with the screen. Yep. Yes, and Jason, you'll be over here. Okay, and Will, you'll be over here. Pop to the other side. Jason, set him up well. Potentially a back cut if it's there. Okay, then the ball comes back to the middle. Yes, if he's not open, then you get open now on time. Okay, you get open.
Now run, boys, come on.
And here we go, here we go, here we go.
Watch the press.
Watch the press.
Just getting a little organized offensively there. Dan Shamir says, watch the press. The Taipans do like to get up the floor. I'm just going back, Drew, to that conversation about Cairns and upcoming free agency. You see the top five scorers there. Abercrombie, the skipper, leading the way. They've only got two guys under contract going into next year, the Taipans. Majuk Deng and Mirko Djerik. Got a few guys on options. Ooh, Kwal, Kwotnoi, these kind of guys in that kind of mix. Binder's in that realm. And then everyone else is a free agent. And I think the big intriguing element of that is the imports. Mm. Especially for me, I mean, to Jim McCall, of course, he's an interesting decision. But also Scott Machado, as Jeng scores off the board right there. You know, he's become a staple there in far north Queensland, just coming to the end of his long-term deal. And whether or not they would want to bring him back, he's had injury problems over the last couple of seasons that have kept him below his best.
Well, they found a good toy to play with down low, haven't they? The big fella, Jawai, making a huge contribution, up to 7 points now, and provides that target. Think about Jawai, he's a good passer as well. This is his size, can throw over defenses.
Jeng outside, he knocks down the three. Let's get to Alex Loughton courtside.
For the Cairns Taipans in the timeout, Coach Ford, really happy with their defensive effort and attention to detail on the scout. At the offensive end, they really found that inside presence with Jawai, really made the most of the mismatches, and really gone back to the well, which is great to see building from the inside out.
It's Jawai once more, muscling his way in. 9 points on 3 of 3 shooting.
He's feeling it. It's his high score in a quarter this season. Jawai, going to work.
On the buzzer. No response there for the New Zealand Breakers because Nate Jawai and the Cairns Taipans have controlled the opening term to lead by 6 points. Quarter time in Cairns. It's the Taipans 24, New Zealand 18. Stay with us here on the Hungry Jacks NBL.
Another swipe over there when you can. Can you fucking?
Well, the Cairns Taipans playing an away game on their home floor. Started nicely. First 4 points of the game, including a dunk for Keanu Pindu. Break
Breakers eventually reeled them in and led by one, but at quarter time, it's a 24-17 scoreline, 7-point buffer for the Cairns Taipans, and today's winner of the $50 Kmart gift card is Scarlett Wild. You go, Scarlett, with a smile as big as you can see. She finished her first ever basketball camp, and that was the reaction.
Super baller.
Super baller.
How good. Big smile on the face. Big smile on the face of the Taipan fans right now, watching on from home. It's been all about the big fellas. Pinder and Jawai combining for 15 of their 24 points at a highly efficient rate around the rim.
Pass from McDowell White, batted down. Deng hits it off quickly. Martai can't complete it.
Got to make. They're the ones you got to make. That's the difference between good and great. You got to be able to finish off those plays. Easy one there for Natai that he misses in the transition. Not sure that's a good shot. But Nate Jawai, the 9 points is Nate's highest score in the first quarter since he had 9 for the Perth Wildcats back in 2015.
Ooh, goodness me, championship.
And he hasn't had a stronger start in the game since his rookie season in 2008. So Jen coming out full of confidence as well. That three we thought he had in the first quarter was only a 2.
They scored the last 5 here, the Breakers. Back to within 4. Machado with it. Shot clock in red numbers. Good penetration and just too nimble there for Wetzel, who needed some help.
Well, Wetzel's been left out on an island, both down in the box and now at the top when there's a switch. Now, sure, he's got to slide his feet and do a little bit better, but when you see that there's that mismatch, he's guarding the point guard, you got to build a wall behind the ball. There was no one whatsoever to help out Big Yanni.
Big Robinson Crusoe.
Machado just waltzed in and for an uncontested layup as he goes by. There it is. Jeng with a little bit of Matador defense. But McDowell White guarding Pinder in the corner. I'm taking the odds to Pinder making a 3 and dropping in and helping out rather than allowing an uncontested layup to Machado. Sometimes you got to pick your options, play the percentages.
Meanwhile, down the other end, they haven't made a huge focus of Yanni Wetzel at the offensive end this game so far. First quarter and change.
Well, they're shooting it so quickly.
A great D, McDowell White on top of Scott Machado there.
They got beat, straight line drive to begin with, McDowell White, which is not ideal. Needs to force Machado towards that screen. And you're able to split the gap, but McDowell White put out the fire at the rim.
Did he ever? Adam Ford was wanting a foul, but that was just good defense.
Machado, alley-oop play. Jip Deng couldn't finish it, though. And Abercrombie.
There we go.
Go solo, and that's a good option there from Yanni Wetzel.
Well, he gave him the business when they played earlier in the season, Yanni Wetzel. And he was good, really good in the first half last week. He spoke about the 23 and 12 double-double he had on the Taipans earlier in the year. So he has confidence against this squad. He's had a really good year. Got to give him the rock.
Dump it down low once again. Wetzel working on Pinder. Oh, foul going to be called on Pinder. Didn't appear to do a lot wrong.
Well, it was all very stationary. Not a lot of movement off the block here. Everyone's standing around. Look at all the defenders. They can all just stay in their spots. And a little bit of a bailout call for Wetzel in the end.
Well, you're talking about going to him and making more of a target of him. They seem to have done this the last couple of possessions. He's 2 of 2 from the field. And surprisingly, in this one so far,
yeah, but that's for everyone.
Zero rebounds to Yanni Wetzel. They've only got 6 as a team, and the Cairns Taipans have got 10. They're shooting identical field goal percentages, 9 of 17, both these teams, which is healthy at 52.9. Let's round that up to 53.
Happy for that. Meanwhile, Adam Ford just responding to the Wetzel post-ups. Brings Jawai back into the game, saying, all right, let's give a bigger, stronger body for you to pound up against in the block.
Back to a 2-point spread. What's as big as 7 when we started this quarter? Chuk Deng needs help. Chawai. Double team arrives. An offensive foul going to be called on Nate Chawai here as Jason Randall just counts the teeth.
Well, I think it's just the size difference. There it is. And we have a look. Which it wasn't the elbow, it was just the upper arm bicep area.
Probably felt like an elbow.
Probably would, and it's just
force.
That's just one where it's unfortunate. His size of him, the mismatch there. He wasn't like he was hard swinging that,
so
that elbow or anything.
Look at that for excessive contact.
I'll let you vent, let it go.
Oh, dear.
Thank you.
Hey.
You saw that time, though, they did send the double team. They had to, because there was a switch and had to come down for the help. There you see Yanni Witzel. That's not excessive. It's just... Oh, there might have been a hint of extension there. Look, it's just that pushes it out, and no doubt it's about the foul, whether it's not going to get upgraded.
Well, just leading with it a little, probably too much, or enough evidence there.
Just leans forward. Get off me, you little fly. That's what he's saying, and unfortunately, that's going to cop him two and possession, I think.
Yep. Unsportsmanlike foul.
That's okay.
I'm happy with that. I don't mind that. You can't even, although it wasn't done with great viciousness.
Vigor.
Vigor. Even though it wasn't vicious, it was still one that you can't have. You can't have the big fella extending the elbow out like that.
Jason Randall to the free throw line. 18 of 21 at 86% this season. But I look at the box score here and I see Peyton Seavers played 6 minutes.
Yep.
Jason Randall's played 6 minutes. Between them, they have not taken a shot.
Mm.
Now, your imports playing that type of minutes, not taking a shot between them just isn't going to get it done.
Well, in Peyton Seaver's case, probably less of a focus because, you know, he's really the man who sets them up their offense, gets them through their stuff. He's had five or more assists in 8 straight games, Peyton Seaver. Has been scoring, ticking it over, but Randall, you want him getting shots and putting points on the board.
Considering they brought him in replacing Jeremiah Martin, who was averaging double figures. But chance now for the Taipans. Lead by 2, 3 minutes played in the second. Again, they're looking to roll the ball down to Big Nate, but Yanni Wetzel denied them that passing lane. Shot clock to 7. Richardo, Gensleton, Jeng, trying to burrow through, found an opening and dishes off to Majuk Deng for the finishing touches.
It's all pretty easy. The penetration, the way in which they get so deep into the paint, got to do a better job of keeping the offense out of the paint.
That's a nice finish there from Jeng as he gets it done and draws a foul. He was just so composed.
And need to get the same message out down the other end as well. Even though they're in a zone, they're in a 2-3 zone here, the Cairns Taipans. But when you're guarding the ball, you still got to play it like there's man-to-man. And that time there, you saw Machado, just a straight blow-by. And it's still, even in the zone, you got some built-in help, but you're still forced into those rotations. That's what you don't want.
Deng putting a good game together here. 10 points to lead all scorers on 4-6 shooting, but can't make the extra. So Cairns still on top by 2. Juk Deng edges in a little closer and adds another 2 to his tally.
Well, it's just carving them up. The Taipans off the bounce from the perimeter, from the block. All a bit too easy right now against this Breakers D.
Penetration came from Besson. The pass was off the mark. And Machado, plenty of support. Ball got stuck just in his hands and there was nothing on offer.
Oh, hello.
Oh, nice.
Look away behind the head pass to find Chawai. He's up to 11 on 4-4 shooting.
Well, he knew he had the switch, Machado, and just had to find a way to get it to the big fella. Searching for the angle and eventually he found it.
Wetzel, hard to the hoop, comes up with another 2.
Yeah, they're going up and down and just need one team to try and get some sort of authority on the defensive end. There's an air ball by Machado. But the ease at which both teams are scoring is highlighted by the field goal percentages. 52% for the New Zealand Breakers, 57% for the Cairns Taipans, because they're mostly around the rim. Just penetration, any type of penetration, rotations are slow. We're either getting the layup, both ends, or an easy jump shot.
Wetzel muscling his way in close and earning a trip to the free throw line once more. And in the new basketball world, where we see teams putting up more threes than twos in a game, mm-hmm. because of what you're talking about, Andrew, New Zealand just 4 3-point attempts in 21, and Cairns just 3 in their 21.
Well, these are the two teams sitting last and second last in the competition for three-point shooting percentage. And although the Breakers have been shooting it a lot better in recent weeks, I like the way they're going about it, both teams today, where they're saying, well, let's establish ourselves around the rim first. Let's get a high percentage shot at the hoop and go outside when we need to. And right now, both of them are getting what they want inside.
Well, Liam, it's also a product of the defense. Most teams with their sets, there'll be some action where you're coming down, you're looking for some penetration, looking for something cheap. But against their higher level defensive teams, that's taken away. None of that's been taken away, or very little of that's been taken away, whether it's a post up, a middle on ball screen, and getting all the way to the rim. Don't need the kick out passes. You don't need that extra option to the 3-point line when you're so efficient getting to the rim.
And that's been a massive issue for the Breakers all season. Not the Taipans as much, although it has been a bit so far today. As the Taipans go inside late in the shot clock here.
Machado, 2 on the shot clock, contested. Whistle on the play as well.
The Breakers dead last in the competition. Defensive effective field goal percentage, which means it's given up a whole bunch of layups, is the issue. And it's cost them in all kinds of games. The three highest percentages that teams have scored this season in a game are all against the Breakers, and all in recent times. So they can look good offensively at times with these Dan Shamir systems, but they've had all kinds of trouble at the defensive end.
Let's go courtside, Alex Loudon.
Yanni Wetzel, just a powerhouse on the offensive end. His activity's risen in the second quarter. A lot more focus going inside. But defensively, he also has to handle a lot of the switches on Machado. That round 11 win against the Taipans by 1 point, Wetzel was guarding Machado and worried him out of that 2-game, got the win. So he does it at both ends.
Oh, dude, there's a 4-point play. Down one end, another wide open layup, missed.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's 3 by last count for me of just simple high percentage, like 90% options at the rim that the Cairns Taipans haven't been able to convert on.
Steadying the ship there, Courtney comes up with his first points in the game. So each time New Zealand close, Taipans find an answer. Bisson. Zupdeng denying Wetzel for the moment. Shot clock rolls to single numbers now. Usman Jang, I think 27% from deep this season. That's off the mark, and Machado the rebound. A chance to expand a 4-point edge. The bodywork was good there from Courtney. So back-to-back buckets from him, and the margin is back out to 6 after New Zealand had scored 5 without reply. The Taipans hit back with 5 of their own.
Dan Shamir calls for time. Way too easy. Courtney on the attack, and Jason Randall talked about Matador defense earlier, Drewy. That was a perfect example of it.
We can talk all you want about strategy. What do we do on the on-balls? How are we going to guard Machado on the on-ball? What are we doing on the low post? But if there is no effort and there is no intensity and no communication, all the strategy in the world ain't worth anything if you can't slide your feet and at least attempt to keep someone in front of you.
Main two shooters when we get out there, we'll be able to communicate it. Let's have you and Bull, all right? So that means Jerk, quiet your back. If it's Wetzel, what I want us to do is like what you did. I think you did it, someone did it. You got in front. We can overcompensate. We good? Okay. You're in the back line. Scotty's up front, so you're at the back of my triangle. We get the rebound, we get out and go. Hey, on a miss, we just match up and be in 5. Got it? We match up, we're in 5 on a miss. On a miss.
Awesome funky stuff here from Adam Ford out of this timeout defensively. So they miss, they're going to match up and be in their man-to-man D. Sounds like off a make, they're going to go into a triangle and 2. going to really just funk it up and junk it up a little here defensively.
Or it might have been, we didn't hear enough of it, I didn't see enough of it. It might be a 1-3-1 when he talks about his triangles, about how you're going to adjust and get those triangles. Maybe you're right though, Liam. But
he wants the five right here, he's saying, so he wants a straight man-to-man.
A little over 3 minutes out from half-time. Cairns by six. Wetzel, again, attacking the rim and earning a trip to the free throw line.
Well, that's just smart and simple execution there from the Breakers. That the Taipans don't have anyone on the floor who can handle Yanni Wetzel.
That's why I think he was looking in that timeout to get a little funky with it, with his defense, and maybe look at a 1-3-1 or a triangle and two, something, just to try and compensate for this size, because you've got two of them out there with Wetzel and Jeng. Now, Jeng spends a lot of time on the perimeter. But
he's long.
He's very long and can get in there, and if it's not the first shot, it's the second shot where they can do some damage.
And the issue here, of course, no Steven Zimmerman, the import center, sitting out hurt. Jawai's got two fouls. Pinder's got three. So they've got the super small squad on the floor.
And they're still on top by four. Scott Machado. Four assists in the game, along with Besson. Noy. Took Deng back to Machado. Shot clock to single numbers. Nothing on offer with the penetration. Took Deng. Dishes to Noy, and foul's going to be called here on Peyton Seaver. Just a tangle of legs. Third foul now on Seaver.
And that set was better. You could see that it took the first penetration they covered, the second penetration they covered. Now on the third one here, there's just a foul called on Seaver, but might have just been the wrong place at the wrong time. Didn't look like there was a whole lot of contact on that one either.
Here's a chance, Usman Jeng, to show some athleticism. With one hand, throws it down. Back to a two-point ball game. Machado exploring. Now spinning back to the middle. And it wouldn't work for him, but the tip-in does for Bull Kwal. Gets his first field goal in the game. Just find an answer every time New Zealand challenge them at the moment. Now White, Jeng against Noy. Got him going the wrong way and helped himself to two more. 14 in the game now on 6 of 9 shooting. Yeah, Usman Jeng.
Great versatility, can put the ball to the floor. If you're looking for an NBA comparison, Kyle Anderson from the Grizzlies.
Oh, okay. Slow-mo.
Where he's not necessarily explosively quick, but just a bit quicker than normal, but can just find his way through the ball carrying. Oh dear, complete and total breakdown on the defensive end. Leads to an uncontested layup. But Kyle Anderson to me is close for Usman Jeng. On how a roll with his size and what he can do, maybe able to contribute.
That's on top of the key. Hills off the three. Only their second triple of the game, back to within a point.
Oh, the prospects. Just lighting it up right now. Jeng having himself a huge first half. 14 points, highly efficient. And Besson knocking on the door of double digits.
Martite against Besson. Tough shot, couldn't get it to go. Retrieves the ball. Now a chance for Courtenoy baseline. That's off the money as well. Abercrombie the rebound. And now down White. Wetzel, good first step. Foul's going to be called on Nartai. No continuation. And free throws to come nonetheless.
11.
Taipans over the limit.
It's all about when he gathered the ball here, Wetzel, after the bounce. Where'd the foul occur? Okay, right there. What do you think, Drew?
Line ball, but I think to me it lent more towards it should have been an N1. A little hard to tell what the officials, where they're saying the contact's made and where he's got the ball in the hand. And
Dan Shamir wants to go on with it a little.
Dan Shamir is testing the limits of the officials. And they've said, just back it up a yard, please, because we've had a gutful.
Is that what they said?
I think so. Pretty sure.
Are you afraid of defending with two fouls? So why are you not switching the right way? Switch hard. We're just switching. We're going to lose another game of switching defense. Shove him in, step up into him and move your legs. Nobody drives on you. Battle that. Okay, he's coming into the screen, you shove him into it. You don't let him get into it and you get him in there. Okay, no Jawai. Jawai still out, we stay like that. Yep. Don't over-open the right hand. Okay, play as you feel it, okay? He's more explosive going left. That's why we told you to force him right. But I told you over there, do not overdo it because he can also go right. Okay? At the ATO, if you didn't pay attention, starts with the screen. Elbow screen and then the up screen. Okay, just like four chests. Okay, that's ATO.
Well, I don't know about you fellas, but I'm here for the Dan Shamir timeout.
I love it. And just like I said, I would be fixated and I would hear every word just because of the delightful accent.
Well, the accent's very nice.
And it just gets your attention.
The turn of phrase as well.
Yep. And that one there, I think he's making a good point when they're running that switches. Now, he was referring to Hugo Bosson when he comes off and how in which he's got to guard him. But the other issue is if you're switching and you switch and you're guarding going on to the roller, you've got to get into the legs of that roller. You've got to make it a war to roll to the basket because you're going to have a mismatch. And if there's a size differential, you've got to get in front, because it's going to be a huge mismatch. So, yeah, certainly Ugo has got to do a better job of what he's doing when he hands over, but also how you guard the rollers, just as important, because that last time they both went to the one man and led to an uncontested layup around the rim.
Well, the Breakers have scored the last five and are back in front here, 42-41. They led by a single point in the first quarter as well. Sticking with it inside the last 60 seconds of a first half where no more than 7 points has separated these teams. Shot clock at 10. Ooh, Kual elevated quickly and grabbed their attention.
Ooh, with some authority. Ooh, Kual down the lane.
8 points in the game now for Bull Kual. Only Jawai with 11 has more for the Taipans. Wetzel in this quarter, though, has been dominant with 10 points in this term. And outside, Will McDowell-White comes up with the three.
And the adjustment by Bull Kual as well is we saw he went 1 of 11 from the three-point line. He's got those points tonight. He's yet to take a three-point field goal attempt. And why would you when the ease at which you can create a scoring opportunity at the basket?
Did we get an answer on that Bull Kual Rookie of the Year question earlier, Case?
No, we didn't.
Did Drew come to the party on
well,
that one?
Just trying to consider the alternatives, and with plays like that, he's going to go up in my estimations about Rookie of the Year type awards.
Well, the man he flushed it on is eligible. Usman Jang. He's eligible. That man, your guy, Ugo Bosson, is not, because of the funky rules and regulations about how old you are and your previous experience as a pro. Mentioned Luke Travers, Azalea Arthur, Mason Peatling. Mentioned anyone that takes your fancy?
Well, I think Usman Jang has got to be right there in contention. And I think it's got a bit to do with, you look at these are the two bottom teams, and it's the opportunities that these young players are getting which allows them to be in greater consideration than some of the other players that from time to time, not just this year, but historically, are playing on those better teams.
But the ball didn't move.
Then, go back, let's go.
Never a dull moment, Dan Shamir's around.
All right, here we go.
The Breakers will restart here. Last play of the first half. They're up to their biggest lead in the game. Jang looking to expand it. The three ball is off the mark. So after being down 7 at quarter time, the New Zealand Breakers have come up with a 2-point lead here at the major break, 45-43. Good fight back.
Good response from the quote-unquote home team. The Breakers in that second quarter, Yanni Wetzel in particular, they made a focus of him. He went to work. They ticked the scoreboard over and just a solid job defensively, and they're right back in this thing.
Let's get courtside for some reaction.
I'm here with Yanni Wetzel. A quiet first quarter, but the second quarter really lifted your activity and everything was flowing through you through that. How did that feel that second quarter?
Yeah, I was lacking effort and intensity that first quarter, and then made some plays out of the post, and then we started going to it a bit more. Found some guys for some open shots, but I mean, our first halves have been great these last five, six games. It comes down to the second half, especially defensively.
Well, the offensive effort also drew fouls on the Taipans bigs. You got them in trouble, but defensively down the other end, how are you going to adjust for the second half?
We were going single coverage on Jawai at first, and that clearly wasn't working. He was killing all of us, so we started doubling. We just got to make sure our rotations are on point in the second half.
Good luck in the second half.
Cheers.
Terrific second quarter by Yanni Wetzel and the New Zealand Breakers. They come from seven down at quarter time, outscore the Taipans 28-19 in the second to take a two-point buffer in at the major break. A rare win beckons for them. We'll be back with more on the Hungry Jacks NBL in just a moment. And final game of round 17 in the Hungry Jacks NBL. And this is a tight one. 45-43 is the margin in favour of the Breakers. Biggest lead we saw at any stage was a 7-point lead for the Cairns Taipans at quarter time. The credit to the Breakers, made some adjustments, came out in the second there, got Yanni Wetzel involved, and was able to stifle the Taipans at their offensive end. And good game going here.
It is. It's a beauty. 45-43. We've got a close one. And what I think this one is also going to come down to, it's not just about the skill test. When you've got the two bottom teams, they're not going to figure in playoff action. It's also the character test. How badly do you want it? And I think on the defensive end, we've seen some pretty lackluster efforts. We heard the coaches talking about the switching. It's led to some easy baskets at both ends of the floor. And the team at halftime that comes out and can just crank it up a notch on the defensive end, I think will have the advantage, because Yanni Wetzel got going in that second. And Jeng with his 14. And down the other end, Nate Jawai, he had 9 of those 11 in the first quarter, and Majuk Deng with the 8. But both teams have spread it around a little bit, but it's the ease at which I think the Cairns Taipans are scoring, because you look at these shooting field goal percentages, that is not normal.
Well, have a look at the three-point numbers from the Taipans. He made this point before, Drew. 2 of 5, only 5 three-point attempts in that first half, and that's after going 5 of 29 from three-point territory against the Southeast Melbourne Phoenix the other night. So they've made a big adjustment in that regard, and they're right in this game.
They're certainly doing a much better job of it, and someone who's doing a good job of it at the moment is Usman Cheng. Turned it on there in the second quarter. He averages 7 points per game. He's got 14 here at the half already.
Well, it was a big first half from the young fella. His best half from a scoring perspective on the season. His career high is 17, so he's one bucket away from knocking on that door. And he's shown the whole package from outside, ability to put it on the floor. There he turns defense into offense by getting in the lane, and here just wheeling and dealing off the bounce as he slices to the cup. So a really nice first half from Jing as he puts his skill set on display.
And he's a big fella. You saw the handles he had in traffic too. When he gets in the paint, the little step back behind the back and still works his way to the cup for a nice finish. 6 of 10 from the field, 1 of 4 from the three-point line. And throughout the course we've seen with him so far, he can see the stroke is there. Now, his numbers, as you read them from the three-point line, aren't great, but you can see why the NBA scouts like him and like his length, because and that stroke, he keeps working on it. It's the type of stroke that ultimately will see better numbers than what he's dishing up from the three-point line so far.
He's young, really young, still only 18 years of age, Usman Cheng. I mean, is he a lottery pick in your eyes, Drewy?
No, he's not. March Madness going on right now, and there is some people that really can flat out play. So I don't think he's in that lottery pick conversation, but I can see why the NBA guys like him. I think that, you know, with 30 teams, you can get into that first round, and happy days from there. You're still making quite some loot if you get into that first round. And you get an investment in you that will see you have time to develop. Anyone that picks him up now in an NBA team, they're not looking at him like a LaMelo Ball or Josh Giddey that can come in and have that instant impact. They're thinking about him 2 or 3 years down the road when they get him into the gym, fix up his stroke, get some bulk on him, gets a little bit quicker, and oh my glory-filled days. That would be a special Usman Cheng that we'd see out there.
He's certainly an attractive player to watch. And we go from one of the youngest players in the game to one of the most mature players in the game in Nate Jarwai, and he can still get it done as well. They can't handle the big man.
No, he had a really big impact in this first half. 11 points? A new season high. And as Yanni Wetzel told Alex Loudon, they tried single coverage to begin with, and this is what Jawai did to it. So all of a sudden then they start switching, and Machado finds creative ways to find the big fella down low, and he's put a really efficient 11 points on the board without missing a field goal.
Scott Machado played all 20 minutes of the first half, 5 points, 5 assists. Why don't we see that more with a player not sitting down?
Well, that's true. I think tonight it's been a bit more out of necessity. You haven't seen much of Kenny, and with Machado, he can deliver it. You saw in some of the funky passes that he was throwing, he can make his teammates look better. But I think it's just the circumstances, and I agree, there are times, particularly when you're down on a little bit of talent, but they try to play at such a high level on the defensive end. They feel, a lot of coaches feel, that if you're playing that full 40, you're not going to be able to give it at the defensive end where the priority is going to be. So that's usually the explanation. But that man on there, on the flip side of that, has only played 6.5 minutes. Peyton Siever spent a lot of time. So he's got a lot in reserve, and expect to see him a bit more in the second half, you'd think.
And we spoke about him and Randall, Jason Randall, 10 minutes, hasn't taken a shot.
Neither of those guys. 0 points for Siever as well, 0 assists and 3 fouls. Rough first half for the imports.
Yeah, certainly. Interesting scenario with the second half coming your way. When these teams last played in round 11, 1 point ball game. Here we are at halftime, 2 the difference. Settle back, going to be another tight finish. One suspects it's New Zealand at home in Cairns against the Taipans. 45-43 is the halftime score. Hope you can stay with us for the second half in just a moment. Round 17 of the Hungry Jacks NBL almost set for the second half in Cairns where New Zealand lead by two. But first, let's get to Alex Loughton, courtside a little earlier. Just spoke with Adam Ford, coach of the Taipans.
I'm here with Coach Adam Ford. The first half really set the pace, getting those scores inside the paint and building out. Was that a purposeful strategy for this this game?
Yeah, we're still trying to find our balance of when to shoot the perimeter and when to get onto the rim. And so, again, a little bit of post focus and wanting to get Nate rolling when he was out there was a big part of what we wanted to do. So now, hopefully, recognising that they're collapsing a little bit more, we can open up some shooters and look to make some.
We out rebounding them by seven, so you're ticking a few boxes in the categories, but 66% in 2-point field goal percentage. How are you going to change things up defensively?
Yeah, we tried. We tried going a little bit of zone, which worked well for us. We tried to go a little bit of 2-3. We mixed up with a bit of triangle and two. The man defense is pretty disappointing at the moment, and I know we got some guys in foul trouble, so we want to be more aggressive, but, you know, if we're not smothering and being aggressive, then we're letting them walk in and get the shots that they want, so it's all effort.
Good luck in the second half.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Adam Ford there with Alex Loughton courtside. And the Taipans, the first score of the second half, are tied away at 45 apiece. Breakers, well, they're going with Wilmack McDowell-White to start this third quarter with Peyton Seaver and those three fouls just coming off the bench.
Good effort from Keanu Pinder, these first couple of possessions. Adam Ford mentioned we've got a couple of guys in foul trouble. We've been having trouble in the man-to-man. He's got three fouls, and they're going at him. Yanni Wetzel, they're throwing it to Wetzel, and he's trying to make plays. And Pinder just walling up, staying straight, staying vertical, and making things tough.
Machado picks up the dribble. Nice finish as well. Quick release.
Well, that time they switched the cutter. They run a little shuffle cut and they switch on it and just catch and shoot. Kind of like that one there from Abercrombie. A little bit more pressure. But when Yanni Wetzel switches and they take him out to the perimeter, he's still got to be able to put a hand up and contest that shot. And there we see another foul. Just trying to get over the top. Let's have a look. There's the hole by Lowe. Tried to stop the roller getting to the rim.
Second personal for Rob Lowe. Five unanswered points to start. The third quarter has Taipans back on top. More than 7 points have separated these teams at any stage. Machado picks up the dribble, now needs help. Again, it's Noy who he goes to. Well done, Wetzel, stayed in front of him, and then eventually Noy was able to get the better of him.
This is good to see. Got Noy growing in confidence, making plays, catch and shoot three. Knocks it down.
I think it's going to be a tech. Uh-oh. Is that a tech in the background I heard?
He's down up and about.
Is that what you do to the game? You understand? That he pushed in.
Don't line up, guys. So you don't line up.
And you're calling it, don't you?
Don't line up. And you need to focus on what you're doing, okay? No line up, please.
Thanks, Shamir.
Don't worry about the coach then. Let's go. One.
Got some fair complaint, I think, because it did look like that he did clear out some space for himself with Yanni Wetzel down low. And they don't penalise him for him. So they shoot now. They shoot the free throw. Now it's come back. Everyone's back in. You only get one free throw for a tech, and play resumes from where it tipped off. And
yes.
And Dan Shamir trying to go through it. I think he's got a valid complaint, but it's sometimes time to...
And then a technical foul on the coach.
To okay, move on.
He's just keeping count over there.
Well, you have to feel for him. It must be tough and frustrating. And when you're up against it, you don't need things not going your way.
But he pushed him, didn't he?
He did. You're right, Dan, but it's time to move on because you've got more important things, which is in your control, is the scoring. This Cairns Taipans team, the last five games, they've only been averaging 75 points. They're going to do that in a canter, and that says a lot about the defense. And down the other end, we've got more complaining because they think that there was a lot of ball on Abercrombie as he went to the cup.
Well, that was Pinder. At the rim there, trying to prevent Abercrombie, and that'll be his fourth personal. You see Pinder coming across. Adam Ford lost his coach's challenge earlier, so that's not in play.
I think that's a foul. Looked like there's a lot of arm in that as well. So, and sometimes in games you can look at it and you can, given that that's his fifth, is it?
Hold on.
In fact, it is.
Okay.
So that's it's going to leave him a little skinny in the middle.
Up his fourth. He had three a moment ago. I missed that.
There was a lot of arm in there. So I think that was a good call. But
He needed to come out, Drewy.
Because he got a tech by the looks.
Pinder.
Yeah, so he had the three. Then he got the fourth. And then he wasn't happy with it. So the look of things, they've said, we'll cop that.
Gotcha.
Big fella.
Okay.
You need to, here's a tech.
Hit the road, Jack.
And then the thing about this complaining is, like I was saying, a lot of time there's very little margin between any of the teams. And an official's call here or there, those 50-50s where they don't get your way, you want to get upset. But right now, with the defense that these teams are playing, they've got more problems to think about themselves than they have about any of the officials, those 50-50 calls. Mm. Sort out what you're doing on the defense and play some defense before you start pointing the finger at the officials.
Good point, Drewy. 2 minutes played here in the third. Cairns on top by two. New Zealand started this quarter leading by two. Shot clock to 10 as Machado joins in. Noy works inside. Rob Lowe gets down low, makes it work, and draws a foul.
Yanni tried to get out of the way. He went over to help. Again, a straight line drive. So watch this. They swing the ball. He comes to close out. Rob Lowe loses his feet. Straight line drive. Yanni Wetzel tries to get out of the way and just doesn't get out of the way quick enough and gets called for the foul. And Cairns Taipans get the and one.
And, of course, that's the threat of Nathan Jawai in the block. You get the switch, you get the mismatch down low, and everybody starts panicking.
It is.
Overhelping, long closeouts, and everyone's scrambling as a result.
But short, sharp, choppy steps when you're closing out, big fella. Don't just fly by. An easy transition. They extend their defense up and they break the press. But Rob Lowe comes out and said, well, I'm just going to make him shoot over a hand and stop the blow by, and then you don't get that foul. And again, his percentages take the odds.
McQuall bounces into McDowell White and it's going to be called for the foul. So free throws to come now for the Taipans. New Zealand over the limit in just 2.5 minutes in this third quarter.
Well, they're coming out and they're trying to be more aggressive. Clearly, the halftime break, Dan Schmier's focusing on their defense and about the ball pressure and how they got to get up. You saw it in a wild closeout. That's because you're trying to do the right thing, but you've also got to be smart about the way you go about it.
Said it. Hugo, you're going first. Will's coming second. Let's hope for Hugo.
So getting it done from the stripe, 5-point buffer again. Well, the Cairns Taipans playing at home, on their home court at least, for a New Zealand Breakers home game. Early stages of the third. Besson. Adam Ford chiming in the background. His Besson firing unsuccessfully. Wetzel got a piece of it, got it to Lowe, back to McDowell White. So fresh shot clock. McDowell White. Nice work. Out of way down low to come up with the two. Margin cut to three. Here's Jawai with a push off on Wetzel and just rolls to the hoop for two more. 13 on 5 of 5 shooting.
No weak side help.
Yeah, it's been a defensive disaster for the Breakers since half time. You can talk about the 13 points in 3 and a bit minutes plus the 5 fouls. As they just put a band-aid over a little bit of their problem from long range right there, but down this end of the floor, having all kinds of issues.
Juk Deng out Jawai again against Rob Lowe. Wetzel provides the double team, and the pass is ambitious. Around the body from Jawai, and they turn it over for the 9th time. Breakers with 6 in that category. It's quite an arm wrestle here. And these teams play back in round 11. New Zealand led 55-35 at half-time in a lopsided first half, and then were outscored 49-29 in the second when the Taipans had their half, and it ended up a one-point ball game. And here's Joe once more. First miss of the game for him. Took over 4 minutes played in the third. Lowe takes the bump and finish it off, and just pulled up a little short as well.
I suppose we haven't seen Ujman Jeng a little earlier. He was good in that first half. Even when, I suppose when they're both these coaches are trying to find combinations more on the defensive end than the offensive end, because they're putting up points. Both teams shooting at a really healthy clip. 53% for the Breakers, 54% for the Taipans. So it's offensively they're getting what they want. Cairns Taipans also doing a great job on the boards. They lead that category 21-13. But it's trying. There's my man. Just as I speak, maybe they're wide in. Dan Schmier's wide in to the commentary team. So no, that sounds like a good idea.
Margin cut to one. And they get it back again. Eight on the shot clock here for the Breakers. Chance for them to retake the lead. And foul going to be called as Besson was on head contact.
Tried to put him in the spin cycle and just lost control, it looked like. Here he is, quick spin.
Ooh. Who's out, guys? Who's out?
Who's the fouling?
It was a bailout call. You have, still have your coach's challenge, you win that one. Because it was a phantom whistle.
I'm not sure. Who did they actually call the foul on? Was it Deng? Was it Deng?
I believe so. So the Breakers with a chance here to retake the lead. Jeng had 10 of his 14 in the second quarter, closing in on his career high of 17 here. And the Hungry Jacks NBL comes up empty on this occasion. Middle stages of the third. Machado. Nartai. Another three from the field. Get to score in the game. Feeds back door. Bull Qual down, but the pass was outstanding to get Inger involved for his first points.
Beautiful pass. Hanging in the air, just making something out of nothing. Finding Inger for the bucket.
On Abercrombie. Extra pass for Rob Lowe from close range. He makes it work.
Well, they're really little, the Taipans, on the floor right now. Gone back to that small squad. No Pinder, no Jawai. And there's opportunities for the Breakers right at the hoop.
Game New Zealand foul, so free throws to come for the Taipans.
Here's that pass from Bull Qual.
Nice.
Over the shoulder, right before he landed. Beautiful.
Thank you. And still 4.5 minutes left in this third quarter. We know Pinder has fouled out in this term, and Jawai's got four.
Mm.
So this is an issue for the Taipans in terms of trying to match the size. And come back to what you mentioned just a few moments ago, Liam, about the coach's challenge. I'm almost getting to the stage where I think that even if you think you can make a challenge and win it early in the game, you're better off. It doesn't matter right now.
It's got to be categoric. That one even, the challenge.
Even if you lose, if you get the rough end of a 50-50 call and they take it off you, I think you're better off saying, look, we'll live with that. No. The score's 10-9. Mm. Just keep playing. I might need it later.
No, 100%.
With your case.
But if there's one that's absolutely a howler, then that's the only time you're ever going to test it. And those 50-50 ones are what can bring you undone. And well, Siva, he just wheels his way through an uncontested layup and puts his first field goal on the board. He's one of one.
An offensive foul called here on the Taipans. Breakers starting to warm to the task here. Tied it at 59. Both teams have led in each of the two completed quarters.
Oh, dear.
A little over 4 minutes out from three-quarter time. Both teams the bonus now.
Travel.
Usman Jeng called for the travel, so turnover number seven. for the Breakers.
Good opportunity here for the man who was guarding Usman Jing on that possession, Braden Ingo, young Kiwi DP for the Taipans. And with no Zimmerman and those two other bigs in big-time foul trouble, he's getting some run here in a tight game.
Turned 23 early this month. Good ball movement there. And an easy finish as it was for Portnoy. 14 in the game now for him, including 9 in this quarter. Out of the 18 that his team have come up with since halftime. This Seaver, penetration. I thought of a travelling violation there. And handy dance move from Adam Ford on the sidelines as well. Let's go courtside to Alex Loughton.
New Zealand Breakers obviously having a hard time guarding that on-ball. The Taipans are slipping out of that on-ball screen. I really would like to see that third line rotation come across and provide that help on that roll guy that slips out just to really tighten up the screws defensively. Otherwise, this is just going to go back and forth.
Yeah. Seaver, Jing, travelled again.
Gee whiz, a couple of turnovers. Both these teams in a position just to try and get some sort of advantage. And a few sloppy plays. Last few possessions become really sloppy. And you're right with...
I think Adam Ford was just given a warning for bad dancing. He was just a little too animated.
Jumping up and down. He thought it was a travel. And he
it
didn't.
Was real sort of foot stomping. It was.
Throw the toys out of the cot type behaviour.
Bukwal bullying his way down low and earning a trip to the free throw line. They've taken 18 free throws in the game so far, the Taipans, including 8 in this quarter already.
I was going to say both teams are having trouble keeping their opponent off the free throw line because they're having trouble keeping the ball in front of them.
Mm.
And as a result, off the dribble penetration and the deep catches, plenty of trips to the strike.
It is, and Alex's point is absolutely valid. It's been both these teams, the weak side help and the rotation, but as you just mentioned, the problem is it needs to be there so quickly because the direct straight line driving, there's not a lot of containment of the ball. And when you're on the weak side, sometimes you need a count just to get over there. But a quick rip. They're finding their way to the basket, particularly for the New Zealand Breakers.
Taipans by 4, less than 3 minutes out from three-quarter time. Seaver, too nimble for Noy, who came back. Good help D there from Nartai as well. Randall fires, couldn't come up with it. His first shot of the game arrives with 2.5 to play in the third. Whistle off the ball here, referee Mark Mill.
Bonus 2.
More free throws to come.
Bonus got a question 2. For you, Drewy.
Please.
Talked about your boy, Usman Jing, as he checked in before.
Mm-hmm.
We know you're a big fan of Hugo Besson.
I think he's got some upside.
Fun to watch.
Very fun to watch when he gets cooking.
And I've heard you speak glowingly about the improvement this year of Ariel Hook-Porty.
Love it.
Who we saw earlier this year foul out in controversial circumstances.
Mm.
If you were an NBA GM, forget where you're drafting them, what pick you've got.
Mm-hmm.
You had the opportunity to have one of those next stars join, or two of them are next star, one's an import.
Yep.
Join your squad next season.
Hook-Porty's my choice. Hook-Porty. I think his size, the way, the growth that you've seen in him over the last, this season, his size and his mobility. When he first got here, he was out of shape. He was blowing after 2 or 3 times up and down the floor. But he's got in shape. He helps out. He can protect the rim. And he's that little left action that he's got down on that low post, he's unselfish. He passes the ball. I think he's good. You can't teach that size and that athleticism. Now, all of them, I think, can maybe we'll get an opportunity at the next level. But to me, I like what he brings with that size.
I've been impressed with him as well. I saw him play in Adelaide earlier this season and up close. Just the way how hard he's prepared to work and run and go from coast to coast. He's averaging 8.5 rebounds, 54% from the field. And he's getting to the free throw line on average 2.5 times a game. So there's a lot of upside for him. We know he can block shots as well. In his last couple of games, 11 points, 5 rebounds and 2 blocks.
Yeah, he's been hugely impressive. And as we've spoken about, Drew, just the improvement he's shown over the course of this year has been terrific.
But I think on all the draft boards, he's probably the lowest of the three, isn't he?
There's some snoozing going on there, no doubt about it. A little bit of sleeping on Hook-Porty. I would take Jing. if it was me in that situation.
Yeah.
He's almost a full year younger than Hook Porter. Yeah. 6'10". He's just starting to kind of grow into that body and get a little comfort. But the skill set, you can see how silky smooth he is. And when all of that, I think, comes together, he has the potential.
No, you're spot on. It's a line ball between those two. I agree. I think that he's size. But the thing about Cheng, as we've seen him, to me, he just has, he needs a rocket up him. He needs just to play with a little bit more intensity. And that may have to do with his age and just the role that he has here. But just in that, it's a dog-eat-dog world, and that NBA standard is eight Seaver.
Okay.
He starts to get things going. 7 points now, 2 of 2 from the field. Just the intensity of Cheng, if that comes together, then you're probably right.
7 in this quarter, 2 for Seaver, starting to warm to the task. 3-point ball game, a little over a minute out from three-quarter time. Lob it down low, double team, and obvious foul. So more free throws to come here for the Cairns Taipans. So you like Cheng. What about Dyson Daniels then? Would you take Cheng ahead of Dyson Daniels?
No, I wouldn't. He's the main one.
Daniels is the man you'd go for.
Yeah, he's ahead of those. And he's in Dyson Daniels, if you look at his numbers from the three-point line, he went over there as when he went to the Ignite team. Is the question mark about, well, can he consistently deliver from the three-point line? And you look at his progression, and his last 8 games as compared to his first game, the last 8 games he's playing, I think he was shooting at just above 40% from the three-point line. Mm. So he really eradicated a lot of concerns that some of those NBA people would have with Dyson Daniels, and he's an elite athlete.
Top 10.
Well. He's sneaking on there. He's around that mark.
Shout out to the old man.
Yes.
Ricky Daniels, Bendigo Braves, great.
Well, I don't know his name, and apologies for it, but there's a young fellow, I think he's in the under-6, another Daniels coming through has just got similar characteristics.
All right.
Deep gene pool.
Yes.
Meanwhile, interesting tidbit in this game right now.
Sniper just fell over. Peyton Seaver.
Taipans have more Kiwis on the floor right now than the Breakers do. Jared Kenny and Braden Inga, so their counts are 2. Yanni Wetzel holding the fort for New Zealand.
Done. Cheng with a defensive stop there. And a chance again for the Breakers. Cheng, bit of showtime and fouled by Inga, so free throws to come here. Taking 47 free throws in this game and 23 point attempts. That's hugely weighted in the opposite direction to what we're accustomed to seeing.
Well, only 6 three-point attempts by the Cairns Taipans. Now, they have significantly corrected from what we saw a couple of nights ago where they said, hey, we're not just going to blaze 5 of 29, was it?
Yep, something like that, yes.
From the three-point line where it did not work. And they've said, hey, let's not, if we're going to lose, let's not lose the same way twice.
And that wasn't an anomaly or an outlier, Drew. They've had a bunch of those types of games where, oh my.
2 for 1, quick one for Kenny.
Heads up play.
First score in the game for Jared Kenny's first shot, in fact. Doubles the lead. This is the biggest margin we've seen in the third quarter, 6 points. And shot clock, 5 seconds inside the game clock. Seaver, being good in the third, decides to fire 3 of his own on the buzzer, gets it done. There was some confusion with the clock there. We might have to reset this, but that is a big play from Seaver. He scored 10 points in this quarter, dragged the margin back to 3. So it is three-quarter time, and with 1 to play, Cairns 71, New Zealand 68, a tight affair. Hope you can stay with us here on the Hungry Jacks NBL. What an arm wrestle we've got going here for the third and final game of our Sunday triple header. Never more than 7 points the difference, and that was at quarter time. We turn for home with the Cairns Taipans leading 71-68 by 3 points. Great individual third quarter from Peyton Seaver for the Breakers, who scored 10. And Quartnoy had 11 of his 16 in the third. This is up for grabs.
Well, it was a 28-point quarter in the second for the Breakers, and then 28 points for the Taipans there in the third. So a little bit of a change of fortunes in that third term. Snakes have their noses in front.
See the penetrating. Jeng fires and all the bottom of the net for Usman Jeng. 18 now for him, a new career high. Ties it away in the opening play of the fourth quarter. Breakers have already played overtime three times this season, fellas.
How's that gone for him, Case?
No, not well.
Not well.
I don't mean to answer Case, but no good. In fact, their last, what'd you say, six?
Nine of their last 10 overtime games they've lost.
Jeez.
That's not a good record, is it?
That's going back to 2018. But never more than 7 points, and that was in the opening quarter into quarter time.
Thursday nights was particularly heartbreaking.
Yes. And Wetzel, four fouls. Nartai and Jawai in red numbers as well. And Kiana Pinder, who fouled out in the third quarter. It's already departed for the evening. 6 points, two rebounds. 71 apiece. Taipans have led the majority of the game, be in the 90 percentile. Right now they've got some work to do. Kual puts it on the deck and it rolls home for him as well. And we spoke about the way that they've made the adjustment from the three-point barrage, and he was the main offender, one of 11. And here he is, hasn't taken a three tonight, and he's 9 of 10 from the strike.
And meanwhile, we're waiting for that 50th triple. So I like the adjustment from a strategic perspective. But sometimes you got to give the people what they want.
Ooh, attracting a crowd there, Peyton Seaver. Bull Machuk Deng flying at him. Let's get to Alex Loudon courtside.
Coach Shamir happy to stay in the switching defense, but demanding that the next guy step up. He wants a charge. He doesn't want someone to be half in the right spot. He wants someone to really commit and really set a statement at the defensive end. He's demanding more effort to close out this game.
And it's when you switch and you come out, you've got to dig at that ball, make him retreat, dribble. If they're just switching and they're getting a run-up at the guy switching on, it's pretty tough. And it also helps with that aggressive switch of dealing with the roller.
73-71, 8:50 to play here in quarter number four.
Hey, Tony, just a question.
Was a bit of what we saw on Thursday night. Breakers with the against the Bullets, that heartbreaking loss. The intensity just picked up a little bit in that fourth quarter and the overtime. It was a bit of a sort of an all-star game vibe in the empty arena for three quarters, but you could sense a definite lift in intensity and talk, communication, effort and energy in that fourth quarter. And you can feel that certainly out of this Breakers squad to begin this final term.
Early in the fourth quarter, when these teams played round 11 at three-quarter time, it was 69-67 New Zealand. It was 68-71 this time around. So lots of parallels. And
that one went right down to the wire.
It did.
And Machado had the look one-on-one with Yanni Wetzel for that final play. And the Breakers took the chocolates.
Well, they led by 26 at one stage. Eventually got home.
We spoke a little earlier about perhaps the potential of what the Cairns Taipans may be thinking in the off-season and how in which they can upgrade their team.
Yes.
Where does Peyton Seaver sit in your long-term expectations for the New Zealand Breakers?
Well, he's a re-sign for me. He's a priority re-signing. I like him. And I think he's had an injury-interrupted season and spoke about this the other night. Those sort of little niggly injuries have been an issue for him over recent years. even during his time there with Alba Berlin in the EuroLeague. As Noi front rims that one, but I think in a normal season where you're playing at home, he's a high-level guy. We've seen in recent times what he's able to do. I'd be looking to bring him back.
Yeah. He's missed five games this season. 13 points. He's top 10 in the league in assists and leads the league in steals. There's a lot to like about what he brings to the table as the Taipans earn another trip to the free throw line. Chardo is going there, surprisingly, for the first time in the game.
Let me return the favour, though, Drewy.
No.
Asking questions about the Breakers and free agency. What kind of level of hot property, what sort of target do you think Finn Delaney, who's on an expiring deal, not playing in this one, but All-NBL second team last year, is going to be in the upcoming free agency period?
Well, he would have rather been going to free agency after the season he had last season than he did this one, but I think we've seen enough of him to know that he can contribute to a championship-winning team. You can see him playing a significant role on a championship-winning team, and they're on the New Zealand Breakers. I'm making it a priority to make sure that he's there for the longer term. So he's just got to stay healthy with the right pieces around him.
What if you're not the Breakers, though? What if you're elsewhere? He's never left New Zealand and played for anyone in the NBL outside.
You think he needs a change of scenery?
I'm not saying necessarily he needs one, although maybe he does, because it has sort of plateaued or even dipped a little bit in his production this year.
I think you've always got an asterisk next to the New Zealand Breakers over the last two seasons.
True.
Because of the adversity and the challenges they've faced and how that impacts the individuals.
What if you're someone else around the country? You know,
tough shot right on the buzzer. How about that? Scott Machado, he missed the two free throws and then knocked down the three. A way to dig yourself out of a hole. Still plenty of time on the clock. 7.5 to play. Cairns by 2. Randle off the mark. Chardo reels it in. On the back pass McDowell. Goes on with it. Gets down low. Adds another 2. 5 unanswered points from Scott Machado. Gives the Taipans a 4-point buffer.
Adam Ford. We got it around the 3-point line. He could identify that the lanes were open, and Machado still took his advice and still was able to get there pretty much unimpeded.
See that to Randle.
White 6, block.
Foul on the Taipans, Jared Kenny.
Stop here, mate. Stop.
This is where the shot clock, you see it in the background. Tough shot. Will McDow White, not much he could do there, and down the other end, everyone leaves Machado, and he waltzes in for a relatively easy 2.
10 points, 5 boards, 7 assists for Scott Machado.
Only at 33%. I knew he hadn't had a great shooting season, but I was genuinely shocked when I saw that he's only shooting at 27%. He's 41 of 148 field goal attempts.
And from 3?
15 of 77 at 19%.
Yeah, it's been a rough year. Taipans, as a whole, have had all kinds of struggles offensively, and those numbers are emblematic of those issues.
Shot clock to 3 for Usman Jeng. Decides to settle for the triple. Off the mark. Chawai back into the game, playing with those 4 fouls. So they roll the dice here. A little under 7 minutes left on the clock. Up 4.
Yanni Wetzel, I think, needs to see more of this ball. Get more involved in it. He's 4 or 5 from the field. And Yanni Wetzel can put it to the deck and also create. Catching on the elbow, if he's got big Nate Jawai on him, just a little pick and pop even, and just get a running start at it. And that spin move we saw earlier on, that can create problems for big Nate Jawai at the offensive end, because it doesn't look like they're going to do this. Either team's going to do it with their defense. It's about trying to put points on the board.
The break has come forward. Down 4. But now White. 3 ball off the mark. Portnoy grabs the rebound. His 5th in that category to go with 16 points. Only Cheng with 18 has more in the game. Machado fires the three ball, knocks down another. Now this is starting to open up. So a 7-point lead for Cairns. It equals the high watermark in terms of difference between these teams in this game.
He's feeling good. Scott Machado, that's three triples now from five attempts on the night. We've spoken about his struggles to
getting good looks there.
Connect.
Okay, getting good looks there.
Not having those issues today.
So you got him now. If we don't have good enough angle for the swipe, if it's very deep, you'll show. Okay, and last man will absorb. You'll show. If it gets over here, I'll call it. Okay, I was silent over here. I need to call this. Okay, that's you're trying to go. You're swiping. You're trying to go under. Okay, let's catch him over there. Okay, the looks are good. Let's go for side now. Watch the press. Okay, but get into it hard. Rob, hold on. Rob, let's have Tom going to, yes, to hand it off. Okay, so Rob, you're going to be in the corner. Okay, you're going to be over there. You're going to be on that corner. Hugo, from this side? Yeah, from this side. And Peyton is available. They're shrinking it from you.
Ready for press break.
Go.
It's not great not having fans in the stands. But it does make it easier for the coaches, doesn't it, during the time? They're almost at the stage where they're getting nearer to a whisper because they don't want the opposition to be able to hear what is echoing down from their huddle.
That's true. That's true. And this is an issue for the Breakers here. Scott Machado just heating up. That's what brings everything together for his game. We know he can set up his teammates. And he's an active presence at all times. But if he's knocking it down from long range, it all starts to come together.
It's a nice finish there. Touch of class from Hugo Besson. His first score in the second half. Machado didn't score in the third. He's got 8 of the 10 that Cairns have scored in this final quarter. Bukwal retreats out of the paint. Finds it down to Jarwhite. Low, wrestling with him. He's going to be called for the foul. That's going to be his fourth.
And again, I like that from Bukwal. Yep. You know, it's been he's made a focus of coming off those off-ball actions and just shooting no matter what over recent weeks. But we've spoken about the adjustment he's made today. Tried to penetrate, it wasn't there, backed it out, and then rolled it into the big fella. And he draws the foul.
He said he's struggles from the stripe in this game. The big man, as I mentioned, it's been a big improvement this season. 16 of 18 at 89% coming into the weekend. But once he's started to miss a few, that gets contagious. He's 3 of 8 in this game. But the margin is 5 in favour of the Taipans. 5.5 to play. And the Breakers are right in it. Besson. Sticking a little. And the pass is a poor one. It's picked off by Courtnoy. You fancy his chances here? He's going to give it up. Wanted Bukwal involved, and the foul's going to be called on Siva. That's going to be his fourth person.
So I don't get that with Hugo Besson, that last possession, because he's out the top there. They're playing a little two-on-two with the screener. There we see the foul. And he's wide open. They go underneath, but he doesn't pull the trigger on it. He's 1 of 2. From the three-point line. That's what he's in the game for, to knock down those shots. And it was a cool play. They ran some action to put him in that on-ball situation. They go underneath, he's in range, and he doesn't let it fly. Instead, he turns it over.
So Dan Shamir rolling the dice here. Peyton Siever didn't think he committed a foul.
It was a little sort of a push-off from Bukwal. The hand is in the cookie jar right there. Clear contact for mine. It's going to be an easy review.
He hits the ball. Does he hit the ball first? Hits the ball first.
But look, his arms all up in there, tangled.
Yeah, it's going to be
hard
to overrule.
Defensive position.
Got an elbow to the chops as well, just for when you're ready. Add the injury to insult.
Coach's challenge is unsuccessful. The foul stands on pink one.
So both coaches unsuccessful in this game. Adam Ford burnt his early in the game, middle stages of the opening quarter. And Dan Shamir kept his up his sleeve until the last quarter, but it wasn't a high percentage challenge, you would say.
What's your take on Peyton Siever, Drewy, and the upcoming free agency?
It's really hard to judge him. I think we've seen his very best is good, and that's what I think you're judging it on. Okay. There's been some times throughout this season that whereby that he's had some downers, but the circumstances when you don't get to play at home at all, it's a funky lifestyle that you're living on the road all the time. It's sometimes a little difficult to judge. I wouldn't be 100% sold on him. I'd be checking what else is out there and seeing if something else can fall in your lap. He's certainly good enough to play in this league, don't get me wrong. But I just think he's one that you would reserve judgment on until you see what you're comparing it against.
Playing with fire there, so yeah. He's on four fouls, reaching in, forced the error in terms of a travelling violation on Portnoy.
He's got quick hands though, doesn't he?
He does, and as I mentioned before, Seaver leads the competition in steals, but I look around the league and I don't see him replacing anyone else at the point guard role on other teams. He might be one that you can wait for.
Stepped out.
Oh, that hurts.
What he would have, though, is some currency in Europe because he really played well over there over a long period of time.
Yeah. So a chance again for the Taipans to build on a five-point buffer. Machado's been good in this last quarter. Had a chance to beat New Zealand last time, missed the last shot. Naatai fires. It's been his night. Jordan Naatai. It's 1-5 from the field. But the Breakers, they need to start putting some offensive pressure on. And Wessel does just that. Spins baseline with a nice finish.
Well, that's what I was talking about earlier. Try and get him more involved. That time there's a little switch action. They get him down on the box, just post him up. And that spin move, he's got great body control for a big man and made it look pretty easy.
But where's the double drill? Jordan Naatai, single coverage in the block with Wetzel. That's low-hanging fruit for the Breakers.
It's not even a switch. It's a straight matchup. Naatai was on him again. And just a poor pass. Didn't need to rush it.
Poor pass back the other way as well from Besson. That turned it over. Ojawai muscling his way in. Naatai was there for a long time.
3 seconds.
And the three-second call is made. It's a generous three as well. So the Taipans turn it over for the 14th time in the game. It's four in this period for them. New Zealand has 12 in that category, including three since three-quarter time. So chance to tie it away here, but Besson is short. Wetzel grabs the rebound so they can reset. 16.6 rebounds are the numbers for Yanni Wetzel. This time Besson comes up empty once more. Starting to run out of opportunities. Low scoring fourth quarter. Bukwal is overdue and knocks down the three. 50 for the season.
There it is.
Congratulations, it was worth waiting for. Man. First rookie since Brad Newley way back then in 2005 to hit 50 threes in a rookie season. So it's a worthwhile milestone, but there's still some work to do to get the win.
Quick reply down the other end. Again, the on-ball situation. Little drive, the dive, and great pass by Seaver to find Wetzel for the easy two.
Machado, well done, Rob Lowe, shut him down. Shot clock at 8. Machado goes back to work. Seaver playing with 4 fouls. Sticky situation for him. Machado goes on with it, makes it fit. What a final quarter this is from Scott Machado. 15 points. He's got 10 in this term alone. 10 of the 15 the Cairns have scored off the hand of Scott Machado down the stretch here. Seaver. Besson, shot clock at 10, elects to fire, and it's all the bottom of the net.
That's nice. Drewy called for it, wanted Besson to be a little more aggressive, looking for his shot, catch and shoot, late in the shot clock there, and he cuts it to 3.
Adam Fort knew exactly what's happened. You could see wanted a tighter closeout. He was doing his little jig on the sideline again because he knew what was at stake, a chance to really get some separation down the stretch. And this man here, Machado, in this, particularly the last quarter, he has caught fire. And knocking down some shots, coming up with some big plays to keep that scoreboard ticking over. As I mentioned, their last five games, the Cairns Taipans only averaging 75. They're already up to 86 in this one here. And that's a big one. Peyton Seaver almost conceding that fadeaway with those four fouls. 6 of 14, 3 of 5 from the three-point line for his 15.
Drew, just to add to that point about the Taipans and their scoring this afternoon, have not had a game this season shooting 50% from the year. Right now, 57.4% from the field.
52 for the Breakers, or 51.9 if you want to be exact. So
the Snakes near on 60% from long range on 7 made triples. So they've been getting a lot of what they want at the offensive end.
And doing this without their leading scorer as well, Tajir McCall, who's courtside with an injury and unable to take part, adding more merit to the performance.
They haven't won without him this season. So on the verge of that right here, if they can close it out.
They'll have a 2 minutes out from the decision. Cairns by three. They have led for 90% of the game, the Taipans, but there's never been more than 7 between these teams. And offensive foul, is it going to be called?
No, it's going to be called on Peyton Seaver.
He's out of the game!
He was trying to front. He was doing the right thing, fronting the big fella, Nature White. And they've called him for a hold, so maybe his arms were wrapped around his legs. But he had to. He had to front him when you had that huge mismatch, rely on help from the weak side. There you see Pinder fouled out real early. And Sievert now fouls out with 1 minute and 58 seconds remaining.
17th game of the season for Peyton Seaver. First time he's fouled out as we go courtside to Alex Loughton.
Just taking quite a few three-pointers. I know the last one from Besson went down, but they really want to go through Wetzel to close this game out. Now with Seaver out, definitely a big target for Wetzel inside.
Jarwise struggles from the stripe, continues 4 of 10 now in the game, but the margin is 4 in favour of the Taipans inside the last 2 minutes. Another thriller. When these teams played round 11, it was 84-83 New Zealand. Besson, nice feed. Here's Wetzel. Alex Loughton wanted him involved, and they get him involved, but he's off to the free throw line.
Nice setup from Besson as well. Good execution. Denshamir continues to ride the officials, and I like the fact they're putting Besson in those actions. He's wheeling and dealing off those handoffs and ball screens and makes a good decision there to set up Wetzel rolling to the rim.
I'm still looking and marveling at these numbers of Bull Qual, really, when you consider that Brad Newley was the last man to do it, 2005. So that's a long time ago. A rookie in the NBL hitting 53. So full credit to Bull Qual. But he wasn't on everyone's radar coming into this season.
No,
elevated
sure
into the starting role, accepted that. The tougher it's got, the better he's got. He has produced great numbers, and it would be a great story if he is rookie of the year.
Plays to his level. I think with Knox, it wasn't like he set the world on fire in the NBL 1 competition.
18-5.
Yeah, really good numbers, but not necessarily off the charts.
No.
Jump out at you. So it's at that level. But he's been able to translate it to this level. Those same types of numbers that he's got there, that's been transferable into this competition as well.
And it's a credit to him. It's also a credit to Adam Ford. And I've spoken about for years his ability to scout and to find talent as an assistant for the Perth Wildcats. He'd be there at the crack of dawn to begin sessions at the Next Gen camp, watching all the upcoming young talent. Summer League, he was there. He was watching more games than me at the Summer League. Wasn't missing.
I don't believe it.
Drew was just sliding in around midday, just missed the first couple of games. But Adam Ford was always there, writing down who was doing what, and he plucked this guy out of watching him at Knox, but further than that, before that, watching him throughout his college career at a couple of different stops along the way, and he's found a diamond in the rough.
He sure has. Came to Canberra as a 9-year-old from Sudan. Bull Qual, 10 of 12 from the free throw line in this game. So it's a 4-point buffer for the Taipans, but Abercrombie from deep is a good option for the Breakers. It wouldn't fall.
Stop now becomes imperative. for the New Zealand Breakers.
Jarwhite. And they can't afford to foul either the Breakers or free throws to result. Shot clocked away. Machado's wants Jarwhite. Lowe reaches in, dislodges the ball. Shot clock about to expire. Machado must fire. Can't connect. An opportunity here for the Breakers. Inside the last 60 seconds.
They need a quick one. Whatever it is, it's got to be quick.
Bisson. Down low. Banks two off the window. Gets the margin back to two. Well, this has been an arm wrestle right from the opening tip. Never more than 7 points between these teams at any stage. 18-second differential here on the game clock with the shot clock. Taipans by two with possession. And Rob Lowe called for the foul is going to send Taipans to the free throw line.
That's Jawai, though. 4 of 10 at the stripe tonight. Mm.
And as a team, 19 of 32 at 59%.
Well, what about the combination? They've already had 62 free throws between the two teams. 20 of 30 for the Breakers. And it's been an area that both teams would look back on and think that they could possibly do a little bit better than 59% is something. If they lose this one, that's an area they can clearly identify as one that cost them.
And when you're 5 and 14 on the season, well, they're not, you know, these wins have been tough to get. You don't want to throw one away from the stripe, but nice work from Nate Jarwhite.
Pressure on this one.
Wow. Did he talk that in? He helped it in.
I like it.
4-point lead, 23 seconds to play. Well done, Nate Jarwhite, who steps to the stripe. 4 of 10, knocks down both when they count.
Well, that's the thing. Shooting percentages can be a little misleading. Some statistically great free throw shooters in those last minute of games, mm-hmm. when the game's on the line, sometimes it just gets very tight and not as efficient as what it can be. And by the same token, those that don't shoot it all that well, like we see with Jawai, big moments, they step up. But what Noi, he's been effective in this contest here. He's got the 16 points really efficiently. Able to get to the basket, finish around the rim, 6 of 8 from the field. He's got 6 rebounds. And getting back to some of his best form, and this will do his confidence the world of good.
Runner-up rookie of the year in 2020. And getting the start with Tajir McCall unable to play in this game. And he's come up big, 6 of 8 from the field.
It's the season that got away for Kawhi Noi.
Yeah.
Because we know that he was injury impacted last year, but he came into this one feeling pretty good.
He did.
Back-to-back 17-point games to open the season. And we thought, okay, here we go. He's about to take that leap that we thought he was poised to do, but then a couple of quiet ones and then injury kept him out for a whole bunch of the middle of the season. So nice to see him back playing at a high level.
Yeah, I recall chatting to him in Tasmania in the preseason 4.5 months ago, and he was talking it up, you know, in terms of being the most improved player in the competition.
Mm-hmm. They need a quick score here. A quick score, then try and get something in the backcourt. There's Beautiful. The quick score. Now pressure in the... Well, they time out, so they'll advance it, I suspect.
Was that quick enough?
That is more than they could have ever asked
what
for.
What was going on with the Cairns defense there?
A little curl action off the double, and I think that they were preparing for the next cutter to come off of the perimeter, but the simple Usman Jiang coming off and then following him was going to be Hugo Bosson.
But watch Majuk Deng here. Like, put a hand out.
Where's the...
Have some awareness. Easy layup at the rim.
Well, the golden rule when you're in these situations, whoever's guarding the screener is responsible for the help.
Right.
That time there, here, no help. Help, not here. And he's had to trail it because I don't want to give up the three.
Yes.
And Hugo Bosson was coming around. Now, I think that ultimately was going to be the priority for the three ball, but it was such a gift that they took. So if they advance the ball here, they actually don't need to foul because they'll 10 seconds will come off.
No. Yeah, yep, you're right.
If they advance the ball, then they can play it out. They'll still have enough time to get a quality shot off, you would think. 8 to 10, 8 seconds.
Yeah, it's risky. You would think so.
Yeah. They're not going to advance it. They're going to keep the full shot clock.
Okay, so now they will have to foul.
See if you can force a steal on the catch here.
Or in the back court. Don't double foul until you get into the front court.
Steal. Oh, no! Dangerous pass. Loose ball.
My goodness!
Got a foul now. They missed it.
Missed their chance. And at the other end, two from Portnoy. 4-point lead now. Besson wants to go coast to coast. Couldn't finish it. Wetzel gets the two done. So a 2-point game.
5 seconds.
Imminent. We've got 5 seconds to play. And they'll foul Portnoy here.
Jeez, they almost forced
it.
Game-winning turnover.
Deary me.
Amazing stuff. And then unable to just land the foul to stop the clock. Taipans take advantage. And a heads-up play from Hugo Besson. Good awareness. Here's the trap. That was the moment.
That's the one. Or even that one. Instead, an easy two down the other end. And two here makes it game over. They needed them to miss one. And that looks solid. Nothing but cotton.
Big moment, he's equal to it, Portnoy. 81% free throw shooter. Oh. Misses the back end. So this for overtime. Jing fires the three ball. Oh. It's in a lap of honor. It wouldn't work. Thrilling finish. And just as Cairns had a chance to win it when they played in round 11, well, they had a chance to tie it here in New Zealand, but they came up short, and the Taipans have prevailed here to win their sixth game of the season. It's 93-90 Cairns.
Well, credit the Taipans for getting that win. Loser of that one was going to be on the bottom of the ladder. Nobody wants to be in that spot, and they've got an opponent coming in pretending their home gym belongs to them, and they take care of business to get the win.
Well, they have, and their last 16 games, they've only had 3 wins, the Cairns Taipans, all of them coming against the Brisbane Bullets. And tonight, they get one over a different opponent, and this time it's the New Zealand Breakers again, giving it absolutely everything to pull out a win against the odds, but just come up a little short.
Scott Machado is our Footlocker player of the game. 15 points, 7 assists, 5 rebounds, and 10 of his 15 points came in the last quarter out of the 22 that Cairns scored. He got them home in the end. They prevail 93-90. We'll be back to wrap it up right after this. Well, these teams positioned right next to one another on the ladder was always going to produce a tight game. Never more than 7 points separated them at any stage, and that's when Cairns led at quarter time. New Zealand were on top by two at half time, then Cairns retook the lead by three at three quarter time. New Zealand hit the front in the last quarter and had a chance to send it to OT.